Satmas.
I welcome you all on the daily lecture on power electronics. So in this lecture, we are going to see the basic power electronic devices and their applications. Not only applications, the characteristics and the various usage of these devices in power electronics field. So first we see the basic component of power electronics, that is thyristor. So thyristor is a 3-terminal 4-layer device. So it is nothing but given type of DC switch. So you will be having the 4 layers, PN, PN and the 3 junctions, J1, J2 and J3. So this thyristor is also called as a silicon controlled rectifier. So you have used the thyristor for most of the practical applications. This thyristor will be consisting of 3 terminals, anode, cathode and the gate. So this gate will be acting as a control signal. So without the gate, the thyristor will not operate properly. So gate signal is nothing but the control pulse or the control signal for the working of the thyristor. And the thyristor derived by the combination of metals, thyristor and transistor. So it is combination of thyristor and transistor. From these two words, you are deriving the word thyristor. Thyristors can handle the high currents and the high voltages. So only most of the high voltage electrical apparatus, you are going for the usage of thyristors as one of the active devices. So we know the passive components as resistors, capacitors and inductors. So thyristors will be coming under the active component, and these thyristors will be having rating of 1.5 kA and 10 kV. And the power handling capability will be around 15 megawatts. This power can be controlled by a gate pulse, or we can say gate current of about 1 ampere. So the gate current is supplied by means of the gate terminal. The thyristor will be acting as a bistable switch. So this is the 2-transistor model of a thyristor. So you know that a transistor will be having the PNP and the NPN. So you are going to model the SCR in the form of 2 transistors. So only you are calling this thyristor as a 2-transistor model. So if you take this basic conception of thyristor and if you cut this conception into 2 equal halves, so you will be having PNP and you will be having NPN. So you will be having like this, that is PNP and the NPN. This PNP will be forming 1 transistor. NPN will be forming another transistor. So these 2 transistors can be connected in order to form a 2-transistor model of a SCR or a thyristor. And we are using this one for the various practical applications. And this is the operating modes of the thyristor. So thyristor will be having the 3 modes of operation. That is the forward blocking mode, forward connecting mode and the reverse blocking mode. So in this mode, you will be having the presence of this leakage current flow. So in forward blocking mode, only the leakage current is flowing. So you can say that the thyristor will not connect. So leakage current is also called as a reverse current. So under this mode, you won't be having any connection of the thyristor. So thyristor will be in the stable state or in the ideal state. The next mode is called as a forward connecting mode. So in this mode, a large amount of forward current will be flowing to the SCR. So we can say that more conduction will be taking place in the forward connection mode. The next mode is nothing but the reverse blocking mode. So in this, when the cathode voltage is increased to reverse breakdown voltage, avalanche breakdown will be occurring. So this avalanche breakdown will be causing a large amount of current flow, so which is not permissible and which is not advisable. So out of these 3 modes, the forward connecting mode is the most suitable mode for a SCR operation. So in this graph, you can able to see the various currents and breakdown voltage. So this is nothing but the forward voltage drop, and this is nothing but the forward breakdown voltage. See, only after this voltage, you will be having the increase in the flow of thyristor current. And during the reverse batch operation, so you will be having the reverse leakage current. And this point is called as the reverse breakdown voltage. And you are having the capacitor. Holding current and the latching current. So holding current is the minimum current required for the flow of the current. And latching current is the maximum current up to which the reverse walking motor can be maintained. So these are the various methods for triggering the SCR or for triggering the thyristor. So you are calling this one as the thyristor turn on methods. So turning on is also called as triggering. So when the anode is positive with respect to the cathode, the thyristor can be turned on by one of the following techniques. So mostly one day you are going for the gate triggering technique. But other than the gate triggering, you are having forward voltage, yield triggering, temperature triggering and the light triggering. See, nowadays the light triggering has been popularly used. So you are using a special type of thyristor called as SCR, that is LASCR, that is light activated silicon control rectifier, where you are using the concept of light triggering. So whenever the light is falling on the cathode or the gate terminal, you will be having the conduction of the thyristor. So this is the first type of triggering, that is the forward voltage triggering. So this is the condition under which the SCR is getting turned on. So whenever the VDO, that is the breakout voltage, is exceeded at the rated maximum voltage, the thyristor turns on. So this is the condition for triggering the corresponding thyristor. So whenever VDO is greater than the rated maximum voltage, we will be having the triggering of the SCR. Next is called nothing but the latching current. So at the breakout voltage, rather the thyristor anode current is called as the latching current. That is the minimum value of the thyristor anode current required for breaking down. Next, when thyristor is triggered by exceeding the breakout voltage, the fall time is very low. That is 1 by 20 of the time taken when the thyristor is gate triggered. So this is one of the parameters called as the fall time of an SCR. This is the most commonly used type of triggering for an SCR. So you are calling this triggering as gate triggering. So turning on SCRs by gate triggering is more simple and more efficient method of finding the forward biased SCR. See, before going into triggering, you should know what you mean by biasing. So biasing is nothing but giving the power supply to any component. So it can be SCR, it can be transistor, or it can be any of the semiconductor device. So whenever we say that a device is biased, we can say that power supply, you are giving power supply or power input to the corresponding device. So triggering is nothing but you are giving the control pulse or the control or the gate pulse to the gate terminal of the SCR. So whenever you are biasing the SCR, then you are triggering the SCR. See, under biased condition, all the SCR will be in the active state. Once you are giving the gate pulse or once you are giving the gate signal, you are turning on the SCR by means of the gate triggering method. Next, in the gate triggering, the thyristor is forward breakout voltage higher than the normal working voltage is chosen. So because under this condition only, you are able to accomplish a higher level of the gate triggering. Next, whenever the thyristor is turned on is required, a positive gate voltage between the gate and cathode is applied. So you can't give the control pulse across anode and gate. So the control pulse must be given only between the gate and the cathode. The forward voltage at which a device switches to on state depends on the magnitude of the gate current. So gate current will be having some value in terms of kilovolt. So this forward voltage will be directly proportional to the value of the gate current for efficient gate triggering. So when compared with the other types of triggering methods, the gate triggering is more efficient and more convenient method for turning on an SCR. Next method is nothing but dV by dt triggering. See, what do you mean by dV by dt is nothing but the rate of rise of the input voltage. So under this condition, with the forward voltage across anode and cathode of a thyristor, two outer junctions A and C are forward biased and inner junction J2 is reverse biased. So already told, in an SCR you are having three junctions J1, J2, J3. So
So you are forward biasing the J1 and J3, and you are reverse biasing the middle junction, that is the J2. So this is the condition for efficient dV by dt triggering. So reverse bias junction J2 behaves like a capacitor because of the space charge present there. So we can say that this SCR will be acting as a parallel plate capacitor. So J1, J2, nothing but parallel plates, and the J2 will be acting as the dielectric. So this is the equation for the charging current. IC is equal to C into dV by dt, where C is the value of the capacitance, that is the negligible capacitance, and dV by dt is nothing but the rate of rise of the input voltage. Next. And this is nothing but the temperature triggering. So during the forward blocking mode, that is during the first mode, most of the applied voltage appears across the reverse bias J2. This voltage J2 combines the leakage current to raise the temperature of this junction. So when you increase the temperature, the leakage current further increases. So this process will be a cumulative process, and this because of the rise in temperature, because of the rise in heat, the SCR is getting turned on. So we are calling this one as a thermal runaway. So high temperature triggering may cause thermal runaway and is generally avoided. So when compared with the other methods, you must avoid using the temperature triggering method because there are chances for a breakdown or there are chances for a breakup of the corresponding device. And this is nothing but the light triggering. So already told you are having a special type of SCR called as the LA SCR. So LA SCR is nothing but the light activated silicon controlled rectifier. So in this method, you are applying light across this junction, and because of this, you will be having a slot. So this is nothing but a slot or UC, and it's made in the inner P layer. So when it is irradiated, P charge carriers are generated, and when a gate signal is supplied, it starts to connect. So this is nothing but a type of triggering the gate pulse by forming a spot and by applying the light radiation across the SCR. So the pulse light of appropriate wavelength is guided by means of optical fibers, because there should be some medium for constructing this pulse light. So this pulse light will be having some wavelength, and this wavelength can be guided by means of a suitable optical fiber technology. So this is the concept, LA ACR. So this is called as light activated silicon controlled rectifier. So this is commonly used in HVDC transmission systems. So in normal low voltage DC, you can't able to use this triggering. So this light triggering is used only in high voltage DC transmission system. So this is the various SCR gate control methods. So the SCR, you should have some control over the gate. Suppose if you are not having any control, it may lead to the damage of the device, or it may lead to turning off of the device. So the thyristor gate signal can be of the three varieties: DC gate signal, AC gate signal, and pulse. So this signal should be applied when the thyristor is in the forward bias state, and should be removed after a device has been switched on. That is, even though if you remove the gate pulse, after turning on the SCR will be still in the conduction state. So this gate signal is only for initiating the conduction of the SCR. So after the SCR is getting turned on, even if you remove the gate pulse, the SCR still will be in the operating state. So that is the peculiar property of the silicon control rectifier. But this is not the case in the case of transistor. Next. So this is the thyristor gate control methods by using the DC gate signal, AC gate signal, and a pulse. So by means of pulse means you are going for a positive pulse. For thyristor, it's important to switch on at the proper instance. So there will be various time instances under which you are going to apply the corresponding gate pulse. The DC gate signal is application that is causes the flow of a gate current which triggers the SCR. The disadvantage is that the gate signal has to be continuously applied. So when you continuously apply the gate signal, it will lead to power loss. So So this power loss can be damaging the ACR. So this uses the DC gate signal is not practically applied, because when you use a DC gate signal, you have to apply the gate signal continuously to the corresponding terminal. So this will be resulting in the power loss. Next is the AC gate signal. So in this method, a phase shifted AC voltage is derived from the mains and that is supplied to the gate signal. See, what do you mean by phase shifting means? So according to some concept, you will be having an angle. So the instead of firing can be controlled by phase angle control of the corresponding gate signal. So this phase angle control is a common type of firing the ACR. Next slide. So next we go for the commutation. So what do you mean by commutation? So commutation is nothing but the process of turning off an ACR. So not only ACR, any type of semiconductor device can be turned off by means of this commutation process. So commutation is different from that of electrical machines. So in the case of electronics, commutation means turning off of the thyristor. In the case of machines, it's nothing but the reversal of the current. But here you are going to see the electronics part of the commutation concept. So in the case of thyristor commutation, you are having two types, current commutation and voltage commutation. So in the case of current commutation, the current becomes zero at the zero crossing point. In the case of voltage commutation, the voltage becomes zero at the zero voltage point. These methods are commonly used for turning off the thyristors. Next. So this is the thyristor turn off mechanism. So in all the practical cases, a negative current flows through the device. So when this current turns to zero, after the reverse recovery time, the ACR is said to be regained this reverse recovery characteristics. So this is called as TRR. TRR is nothing but reverse recovery time. So you are having one formula for this, TFR plus TRR is equal to TQ. So this TQ can be called as the ACR turn off time. And the applied power bias voltage can be controlled by this type of commutation methods. And this is the main classification of thyristor. The commutation can be classified as natural commutation and forced commutation. So in the case of natural commutation, so whenever the voltage or current falls to zero, it will be automatically becomes a commutator. Under the forced commutation, you are using some external device for turning off the corresponding thyristor. Next slide. Line commutation, that is natural commutation, is also called as a line commutation. This occurs only in the AC circuits. So you won't be having this type of commutation in the DC. Natural commutation of thyristor takes place in AC voltage regulators, phase control rectifiers and cyclo converters. So you know what you mean by cyclo converter? Cyclo converter is nothing but a frequency changer or frequency divider, which is used in most of the ACR applications. Next. And this is nothing but a forced commutation. So you are using some external circuitry in order to turn off the ACR. So this external circuit will be generating a pulse. That pulse is given to the control signal and the SR is getting turned off. So this force commutation is normally used in general. So these are the various methods of force commutation. Class A, rest control. Class B, self commutation. Class C, auxiliary commutation. Class D, complementary commutation. And class D, external pulse commutation. So these commutating elements such as inductor, capacitor are used for commutation purpose. So normally we are calling this inductor and capacitor as commutating elements. Next. So this is the thyristor or ACR family members. So ACR, DIAC, TRIAC, SBS, LACR, GTO, etc. So with this we have seen the basic concepts of the thyristor. Okay. So thank you all for listening to this video lecture.